And that completes President Obama's speech from the Oval Office, where he talked about the ending of the combat operations in Iraq, something about the ongoing operations in Afghanistan, and the crisis of the economy that continues for all Americans. Mark, what did you think of what the president said?
Jim, I'm not sure. I really am not. I'm not sure what the takeaway from that speech is. I don't know if I was asked to write a lead for it right now, the president spoke glowingly about the troops. The only two individuals whom he cited were General David Petraeus, who's in charge of Afghanistan, who led the surge in Iraq, who was the father of the surge in Iraq, and President George W. Bush. He gave he paid great praise to the troops. That's the one unifying.
And their families.
And their families. And that's the one unifying factor in this whole war. Left, right, pro-war, anti-war, we agree on the troops. It's I think, genuine admiration and appreciation. I think it's also a direct result of what happened in Vietnam, where troops came back and were treated with indifference and disrespect. But he almost held up the troops as the example for the civilian population, that we have,
now,
they're
so
our
true.
Example. They're,
yeah.
they're our example. We have to follow what they've done and their lead. I'm not sure what the lead is out of that speech.
I thought it was a unifying speech. Mark used that word. Santayana or somebody had a phrase that Americans don't settle their arguments, they just move beyond them. And he clearly wanted to move beyond. But frankly, it's just stylistically, I think there's been a deterioration in the quality of Obama's speeches, the literary quality. There's a lot of phrases here that you're not quite sure what they meant. We must give our children the education they deserve. We must jumpstart industries. We must unleash innovation. Our troops are the steel in our ship of state. These are sort of normal political metaphors, but they're not the fresh, high literary quality that I think Obama had a year or two ago. And I think this was marred substantively. I guess I took away two things, and to me, not happy things. The first is that the Iraqis have decided against sectarian violence, he said that. And second, therefore, we must turn the page. I doubt they've turned away from sectarian violence. I think the risk of that is still real. And he said very clearly, we will be out of there entirely next year. There's a consensus about the short-term drawdown to 50,000 troops now. Almost everybody agrees with that. There's real disagreement about what will happen next year if the Iraqi government asks us to stay a little longer. And if Obama really closed the door to that, which I think he may have, there'll be a lot of disagreement with that about that. So that's one policy thing I see.
You see that as
He was quite unequivocal on that point. I mean,
he said no more open-ended wars.
But our troops will be out of there by the end of next year.
But he put it in that context.
That's
there's
right.
No more open-ended wars.
It was funny as I was listening to it. I remembered that this is the 31st of August. On September 2nd, 1963, John Kennedy was interviewed by Walter Cronkite on CBS about Vietnam. All right, where the United States was just stepping into the water, really, and would be there for another 12 years. And John Kennedy said, the final analysis, it's theirs, the Vietnamese, to win or to lose. And Obama, you could almost hear the same language tonight. He said, it is theirs. Only the Iraqis can resolve their differences. Only the Iraqis can build a democracy within their borders. And he glossed over a lot of the differences on the war. In that sense, I guess it was unifying.
Beginning at the very beginning. I mean,
it
began, the problem with
a lot of passive constructions. Things happened. I'm not sure who did them, but things happened.
Yeah. We have persevered because of a belief we share with the Iraqi people, a belief that the ashes of war, a new beginning, could be born in the cradle of civilization. I never heard that expressed before by the president certainly it was something that you heard in the previous administration, but I hadn't heard President Obama say that.
What did you think, David, of the way the president moved from Iraq to Afghanistan and then to the economy?
Yeah, well, that was intelligent because clearly people want to hear about these, not what's happened over the last 7 years, but what's about to happen, what we're in the middle of. And the movement, he wanted to use Iraq as to say, okay, we're done, we're sort of underlined, we've finished that, and now we're focusing our attention on Afghanistan. In that passage, I thought the crucial distinction was not made. His administration has been in an internal argument or civil war over whether we're actually going to begin, how quickly we're going to begin withdrawing down next year. Clearly, Joe Biden wants to draw down pretty quickly, along with some others. David Petraeus and others do not want to draw down quickly. So people are going to be carefully parsing the words there. And he dodged that issue. He did not settle, I think, or tip his hand either way in that internal dispute. But then he focused at home.
But he did make the point. We are going to withdraw.
But then he also said it will be conditions-based, and it won't be, and which is what the Petraeus side wants.
Sure, sure.
So he gave them both something, but it won't settle anything,
right.
I think, ultimately.
Now, what about the economy? He ended on the economy. Was that a cool move?
Well, I mean, he has to come back to the economy.
He has to.
This campaign, this political war at home, thankfully without bullets and arms, is about the economy. I mean, it really is. And every piece of economic news has been confidence building of late, and the numbers in the polls are disturbing. I mean, Democrats were grumbling about, why are we doing this speech? Here goes another week without the economy.
So I'm
wondering what the payoff is politically, just in crass terms, what the political payoff is.
A speech not long remembered, David?
I think so. People remember the Iraq War, but I agree. I don't know why he decided to do this from the Oval. He could have given a major speech somewhere else at Fort Bliss or something.
It was at Fort Bliss today.
Earlier today.
It would have been perfectly ideal format.
Mark, David, thank you both very much. And that ends our PBS NewsHour special coverage of President Obama's Oval Office address to the nation tonight. For those of you on the West Coast, the NewsHour can be seen at its regular time tonight. We'll see the rest of you online and again here tomorrow evening on the NewsHour. For now, I'm Jim Lehrer. Thank you and good night.